rise in worship, that in the midst of two or three, that he would come and he would ruin us forever. I don't take for granted the opening of these doors and the opportunity to come here to connect with the body. I think church community is one of the loveliest things you could ever have in your life. And no wonder God said, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Because there's something that happens that cannot. But that occurs when we are together. Amen. And whether we can see it or not, beloved, whether we can feel it or not, we know that God is faithful to his word. He is faithful to his word. And when we obey his commission, when we obey his truth, things happen according to his spirit's desire and plan. Far beyond our imagination, far beyond our capacity to see, the Spirit of God is doing great things in you, in me, in us, in the earth. Hallelujah. It's doing great things. And it is God's desire that, especially in these times that we live in, that we have eyes to see what he is doing. There is a place where in faith we walk and we trust God, knowing that he is faithful to his word. But as God is faithful to his word, he has made decrees and declarations concerning the times that we live in. He has prophesied concerning the atmosphere of both the world and the church in these crucial times. And the reality is, as pertaining to the church, according to the prophet Joel, his promise is that the spirit of prophecy would rest on the church in these last days. The Bible says clearly in the book of Revelation that the testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. And beloved, this is not just prophecy tied up in eschatology that speaks of God's end time plan. Beloved, this is the prophetic spirit of revelation opening your eyes to clearly discern the hour that you live in and to discern the intents of God's heart. Beloved, this is the greatest time ever to pray the lifestyle of Jesus. That God, what you are doing, I may see, and what you are saying, I may hear. That I may do exactly as I see, and that I may speak exactly as I hear. There's no greater time for the church to make such a declaration and to live such a life than the time that we live in. And my heart this morning, even as I stand before you, is that the Spirit of God would do just that. That there would be a clear clarion call to your spirit. There would be an Isaiah 60 verse 1, a reality on the inside, where the beloved of God would arise and shine, knowing that our light has come. Beloved, your light has come. Beloved, the glory of the Lord is not coming upon you, it is upon you. Hello. And your light has come. You don't have to go searching for it. Beloved, your light has come. The spirit of revelation has come. But what the church needs is the spirit of cooperation. And it is my desire this morning that more than anything else, when we leave here today, that our internal wiring would be aligned to heaven's design. Would be aligned to heaven's design. And that every thing that would want to displace heaven's design in our lives, that it would be crucified, that it would die. And so, Holy Spirit, even as you put your hand on your heart, I'm going to pray. Holy Spirit, you have your intentions set out for us today. And it is your intention that we desire. It is your leadership that we want in our lives. And even as hand rests upon heart, Holy Spirit, we declare that there is a mighty river flowing. There is a fresh wind that is blowing. And it is removing, hallelujah, the chaff. It is washing away the mire. And it is setting us in place to have a heart that is fully yielded to you. Holy Spirit, whatever bound, whatever chain, we thank you that you are so able to break it. And God, indeed, we need that breaker's anointing upon our heart right now. Father, we can look in the midst of our own lives, God, not just only, God, our own lives, Father, but in the earth, Father, and we need your liberty. Spirit of God, we need, even as we sung this morning, for you to break out, hallelujah. But on the inside of us, God, we want you to break out. And we say, have your way. Have your way. How many of you know that if we're going to sing the songs we sing, beloved, we really have to not just get caught up in fanciful tunes, but we really do have to, in singing the songs we sing, bring our lives into alignment that the reality of the things we declare with our mouths would be lived out with our lives. If the Spirit of God is going to break out, beloved, I come to tell you this, it's going to come with a cost. Hello? Hello? It's going to come with a cost. And the Bible makes it very clear. And we can declare all day that Jesus paid it all, but he paid it all to enable you to live as he lived. And beloved, unless we really catch the reality of the grace of God that has been given to us to live and to walk like Jesus, we do take this grace in vain. We will not see the reality of the Spirit breaking out in our lives. How many of you want the Spirit of God to break out in your life? How many of you want more than just a normal, natural, everyday, mediocre Christian life? Come on, how many of you want more than just the norm? How many of you are tired, hallelujah, of the norm? Tired of the norm, come on. I join you, beloved, and I am here to tell you the Spirit of God is tired of it too. And he, hallelujah, wants to see a people, an army arising in the reality of the grace that has been provided for them. Hallelujah. Come on, say, God, your grace is sufficient for me. Amen. It is sufficient. It is sufficient. Unless we forget, in the midst of their challenges, denying his ability working in us to relieve us, beloved, I want to remind you, it is sufficient for you to live and walk like Jesus walked. It is sufficient, I say it again, for you to live and walk like Jesus walked. Beloved, I am so gripped by the reality and I am so excited for the journey of walking like Jesus walked. How many of you ever just took the time to reflect upon the Gospels and you see the activity of your Lord and Savior and you're saying, but Jesus, you said I would walk just like you. How many of you ever said that? You said I would walk just like you. I want to walk just like you. I see this reality of your person and I want it to consume me. Hallelujah. But if you want that reality to consume you, beloved, you got to push the button, call flush, and get rid of you. That he and he alone would be the consuming flame that occupies this vessel and this temple. Beloved, more than any time before, I feel just a strong urgency from the Lord for the church to advance. It's not enough to be settled, beloved, as a stick in the mud. You are not a stick in the mud. And it is not enough to settle, to be comfortable, stuck in the mud, stuck in earthly realities, stuck in earthly operation. Beloved, we have to live out the reality of what we've seen in the Word, that we are a royal priesthood. Beloved, that we are kings, hallelujah, and priests. We have to begin to take action and live out these realities. And action means very practical things. Action means, hallelujah, to stop wishy-washying and wishing and get on your feet, man, and start to put some things in place. Start to shift some things around, that these realities that the Word of God speaks of would become real in our lives. It's time to shake off the depression. It's time to shake off the cloudiness, the mist that we can so get lost in, the worldliness, the materialism, and it is time to sink our teeth deep into the things of the Spirit. I'm telling you, there is a church arising whose one desire will ring so loud in their spirit that anyone who comes in contact with them would know it. And it will be their passion for Jesus. It would be that insatiable desire in the midst of their heart, that longing for the Son to do every and anything to conform to His image, to lay down every and anything to be just like Him. It's coming. It's coming. It has begun. Hallelujah. Somebody say, in me. In me. In me. In me. In me. Oh. Ah. Beloved, God wants us to advance. And in these times, the heart of my message this morning is advance. Sin in these crucial times. Advancing in these crucial times. And the Lord has just been just provoking my heart. Dwayne, advance. Advance. My church needs to advance. 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 Sometimes we're too busy just standing still when the call of God is for action. And it is to advance. Beloved, we see the various calamities that are happening in the earth right now. And more than ever before, the Lord wants the church to advance. He wants you to understand that you are part of this great plan, that you are not just hedged in and put on the side while everything is happening in the earth. Beloved, you are part of everything that is happening in the earth. Actually, you are very crucial to what the Lord is doing. And I say the Lord is doing. It's not the devil. Lest you forget that He is sovereign. Lest we just sing it and forget that He is indeed sovereign, Lord. And that everything that has been orchestrated and that is being played out, the hand of the Lord is in the design of it all. Hallelujah. And unless we understand that the Word of God makes this very clear, we will be like a wave tossed to and fro. We will have no stability because we have no understanding. And where there is no truth, where there is no understanding that enables vision, you cast off restraint. Hallelujah. You're lost. You're unstable. And God does not want that for you. He wants you to be enlightened. He wants these eyes open. I want to read a portion of Jesus's answers to His disciples. In the book of Matthew, chapter 24, to us this morning. And I want to use that as a launching pad to go where the Lord has taken us. Matthew 24. From verse 1, it says, "Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple. And His disciples came up to show Him the buildings of the temple." It's not that interesting. "And Jesus said to them," as they were showing Him these marvelous buildings, sculptures, edifices, He said, "Do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down." And you can imagine the apostles to be the disciples of the Lamb showing Him All of these things that they've been so excited about all of their lives. It was a hallmark of their religion, the place of meeting in the temple of God. And they are showing it off to Jesus as if something to be proud about. And Jesus kind of cracks the bubble. And he says, all right, guys, he didn't even waste words to say, I like what you're showing me. No, he didn't even go there. He went straight to the meat of the matter. Do you see all of these things? Do you see all of these things? They will crumble. Hello? I'm here to prophetically whisper in your ear to tell you there are certain things that you're getting excited about that you find a fancy in, but the Lord wants you to know, hallelujah, that they will crumble. Even certain things that you believe pertain to the will of God, that you believe pertain to the worship of God. Oh, Jesus, look at our expression. Look at our love. Oh, but did you not know? That's passing away. There is a form, there is a sculpture that I am bringing with me from heaven that you do not know. I tell you this, Moses in his glorious days thought he had it. David thought he had it too. But the Bible says there is a temple, hallelujah, of God that comes from heaven in the book of Revelation and that will come to earth. And all of us will be enlightened. But it is not just in our worship. It is also pertaining to the things we believe that are the will of God. That are the will of God. And here they are showing off these fanciful edifices to the Lord. And he says, don't hold these things in your heart. Don't get too accustomed. Don't become a stick in the mud because these things will fall apart. Jesus, if that can just echo through to your spirit to some of the things that you hold so fanciful. But believe you me, I didn't read that to stop there. Surely I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. Oh God. Now, there is a walk that happens in between here and verse 3. You don't really see it, but the Bible makes it very clear because the next discourse is on the Mount of Olives. So you can wonder and ponder at the reality of these guys, what they're thinking in their heart, what's going through their mind as they walk from the temple to the Mount of Olives, which could have been a few hours' journey. And so there is silence. There is wondering. There is pondering. What does he mean by that? What is all of this, Jesus? And they get to the Mount of Olives. And a word is given from the Lord. An answer to questions that are proposed. But just before we go there, do you know that whenever the Lord is releasing a new thing in the earth, when he's doing a new thing, do you know there's always a sword that pierces your spirit? When he was doing a new thing and sending his son, and Mary was receiving this promise, and indeed she did by faith, to carry the Holy One. God made it very clear that this Holy One is going to pierce through many hearts, including yours. I want to let you know, especially if you've gotten comfortable in the season that you're in, that there is a fresh wind blowing, hallelujah. There is a shift that is already upon you. It is not coming. It is already upon you. And it is going to feel a little bit uncomfortable. Hello. It's going to feel a little bit uncomfortable, but it's okay because that's how God works. He offends the mind to reveal the heart, and then he works on the heart. Amen. Tell your neighbor, he offends the mind to reveal the heart, and then he works on it. Hallelujah. Because he needs you to co-labor with him to work on it. But oftentimes, you don't know your own heart until the Lord offends you to reveal it. And then you say, oh, what is that doing in there? Yeah? And then you can deal with it with him. And so that's the journey, guys. But let's carry on the conversation. They're at the Mount of Olives now, and the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be? Now, they're still thinking about the situation back at the temple, the hard words that they heard. They say, tell us, when will these things be? They ask another question, and what will be the sign of your coming? And then they ask another question, and what will be the sign of the end of the age? And so there are three questions. And in all of this chapter, and many people get lost here, because Jesus, hallelujah, is going to give answers in context with each question. And we get lost here thinking that it's for one thing. But Jesus is actually dealing and addressing three different things. However, it is not my role this morning to slice and dice and to go through that as thoroughly as I would like to, because it's not the point of where the Lord wants to take us. But so we can understand, here goes the conversation. Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and it will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Did he just say hated? Did he just say folk gonna die? Was the context of folk dying the church or the world? Church. Then many false prophets. Sorry. And then many will be offended. Many will be offended. They will betray one another and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end, he who does what? He who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations. And then the end will come. And the conversation continues. And Jesus says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Now remember, he is answering three specific questions. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. And pray that your flight may be in winter or on the Sabbath. For there will be great tribulation such as has not been, since the beginning of the world until this time. Nor ever shall be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh shall be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, or there, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. Therefore, if they say to you, look, he is in the desert, do not go out. Or look, he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For as the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For wherever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together. Wherever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together. I want to finish right here. A major point in the midst of this all of this information that the Lord has given, and having to be picked through to discern which question he is answering or not. Out of all of these things, the most important thing is that right there. That verse that offers us a picture of what we need to be like. It says, for wherever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together. And what the Lord is emphasizing here, in the midst of revealing mysteries, things that have been locked up, he's given clues, he's given insight, he's given us awareness so that we can be prepared. But in all things, he tells us this one thing. As the eagles find their food, as they surround the things that pertain to their life, so too we as the church must find ourselves in the place of discernment, where we are connected to the things that would give us life and that will sustain us in these times. And the reality is that God makes it very clear in his word what will sustain us. We know, of course, it is his word. But within his word, there is direction. There is sustenance. There is understanding to help us discern who we need to be and what we need to be like in these times. I want us to turn to Revelations, the book of Revelation. Let's go to chapter 6. Because, beloved, there are many things that are happening in the earth right now. And we must not be ignorant of what the Lord is doing in the midst of everything that is happening. When we see these different groups arise here and we see these different plagues go there, beloved, we must be very aware of what is happening so that we as the church can walk in understanding and not be riveted from our position, shook from our place of standing before God. When God says, and Jesus makes it very clear, that in these crucial times, these end times, that many will be offended, he's speaking towards us. And he's speaking towards the reality that many will point their fingers and they will say, how could God allow such a thing to happen? They will misunderstand. And they would believe that the God that they have worshipped is not God at all. They will be offended thinking that within their heart they know better than God. Beloved, I'm here to tell you, you don't know better than God. You don't have it figured out like God. You don't see like God. You don't understand like God. You don't live, hallelujah, like God. Hello. Now we are called to live and to walk as Jesus walked. But beloved, there is another dimension where God and God alone is God. And he will always be God. And you will never know what that is to be God, because he alone is God. We sang it prophetically, behold, God is great. That is took right out from Job 36, where the Bible says, behold, God is great and we know him not. Even though we are on a journey to know him, he will always be beyond. Hallelujah. But there are things that are happening. There are crises that are shaking the earth. We see and we have prayed concerning the movement of what began of ISIS as ISIS, but now is IS. And I don't know if many of us understand the language behind that, but what began as a movement to take a city, expanded to a country, expanded to a territory, and each time the name changed. So you would see ISIL, and the name changed and changed. And now they're simply IS because they're no longer just interested in a territory, in a portion of the earth. They're interested in establishing Islamic State on the entire planet. But you're not to be afraid. Hello. Hello. They are not in control. Hello. They are not in control. And the devil is not in control. Hello. Hello. I want us to get a bit of sobriety this morning to understand, hallelujah, that those who are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus must see like Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Must have understanding as he's called us to share, according to Romans 8, in that reality of being joint heirs with him. Share in that dimension, not just a blessing here on earth, hallelujah, but blessing in the spirit where our eyes are open and we are not so disturbed as we would find ourselves to be. That we would understand that Jesus is not making a decision to start 24/7 prayer in heaven right now because of ISIS. Hello, hello, but he is in control. Oh, blessed are those who are not offended when I appear, because many will be offended because they don't understand the battle plan. But beloved, God wants to enlighten you to the battle plan. He wants you to know that not only are you going to see the things that he is doing in the earth take place, but you are going to be participants of those things. Hallelujah. And I'm not talking about you taking a bazooka to blow somebody up. I'm not talking about you, hallelujah, doing some craziness in the natural, beloved. I'm talking about your spiritual place and authority and your operation, hallelujah, to unlock, hallelujah, the judgment that is due to the enemy. But prophet, Ebola is spreading. Has that in some way moved Jesus into a state of alertness on his throne? Has he said, oh no, Ebola has reached the West? And has it shook his heart to be in a place now where he has to go to plan B? The Christians didn't pray hard enough. The church didn't do what they were supposed to do. The door got open. And now it's on the West because the East, they deserve it. I want to remind you, he who sits on his throne sits upon a throne whose foundation is righteousness and justice. And he cannot contradict himself. I want to remind you that he is not unnerved, but he is well in control. On September the 19th, Apostle Jane Hammond had a dream where she saw a man land in the United States, and the sign Ebola has come was before her face. Also, following up that sign, another sign was revealed, saying, come into a city near you. And immediately, she gathered those that were on the intercessory team, connected with some other prophets and intercessors around the nation, names you would know, Cindy Jacobs, Dutch Sheets, and so forth. And these guys began to pray for the halting of this agenda, for mercy in the midst of the sovereignty of God. And as she saw it, we know it today, it's now news. It was news to those who could see in the spirit, hallelujah, days before, 10 days before, it was news in the media. But it's there. Yes, they're continuing to pray. Because oftentimes God reveals so that we can counteract what is coming. Hello? We're still here? Good. So that we can counteract what is happening. Then there are other times where God reveals so that we can have understanding of what is about to take place and be prepared. Hello? I'm not going to stand as the judge of which one it is today. It's not my place. But more than ever before, we, the church of Jesus Christ, have to come under the grip of God and find ourselves in right position. Four things I heard the Lord trumpet in my spirit, and I'm going to leave them with you. As we go into Revelation 6, something is happening that continues the story of Revelations 4 and 5. And chapter 5 should be studied because within it, there is an awesome moment in heaven. And there is silence because no one, according to John's perspective, was found worthy to take the scroll and to loose the seals thereof. But of course, the story continues, and thank God it didn't end there. John was apprehended and he was told, "Don't cry, stop the weeping. Behold the Lamb," hallelujah, as if slain, and there was Jesus marching through, taking from the hand of the strong angel, amen, moving him aside and taking that scroll. And then the conversation moves into chapter 6. Because here Jesus is now opening up. Everybody said, Jesus opened it up. He broke it. Beloved, what's in those, what's in that scroll? What is behind those seals? You read on. Most of us know, we've read the book of Revelation. Behind those seals are impending judgments. But who began it? Who opened them up? The devil? Hello? The devil? I want you to interact with me. Did the devil open them up? No. Jesus did. Jesus did. It means he is in control. It means, hallelujah, that this is not the devil's plan, it is his plan. And so Jesus looses the seals. And action begins. And there are four things, as I mentioned, I want to leave with us. That in this season, more than ever before, if we're going to advance, first of all, we're going to need to awake. We're going to need to wake up as the church. Second of all, we're going to need to find ourselves in alignment. Third of all, we're going to need to find our assignment. Last of all, we must abide. We must abide. Revelation 6 verse 1. It starts like this. Now I saw. Who is speaking? John is speaking. And he says, now I saw. And I want to stop right there. Because the reality is John is caught up, yes, in heavenly places, seeing all of the things that the Lord has designed for him to see, so that he can carry this message back to the church. But why John? Why John? Why John? There is one thing about this man, John, when you study him, when you go and read his gospel, when you read his letters, there is something that stands out about John, and I especially love his gospel. Because he always refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. The one who leaned upon him. And there was something about John that just stood a bit different from all of the others. When you really look at all 12 of them. John had this purity, this innocence that was remarkable. Again, as you study the book, his gospel, his writings, you would see it. He is like that child that is always sucking up to mommy or daddy. He is like that child who is the teacher's pet. And how many of us like that child in school? How many of us were that child? Don't put up your hand. There may be some people that still hold grudges. But the reality is that John fit that description perfectly. And often, over and over again, he would be repeated as the one whom Jesus loved. He had this sense of affirmation about his person, that God loves me completely. He is the one that stuck in right there with Jesus, even through to the end, beloved. He was a man who understood he was loved deeply by God. And he, in understanding the love of God for him, loved God back in such an incredible way. Not to say the others didn't. Not to say that they should immediately capture John's sense of self-disclosure. No, we are all different personalities, but there was something about John that went beyond a personality. There was a mark on this man. That when we see him, we think of a man that is passionate for Jesus. That whose mind was consumed. If Peter was consumed or was thinking about along the journey, his family, I wonder how wifey doing, I wonder how the kid's doing. John was there all of the time just gazing, locked in on Jesus. I mean, just dropping and just Jesus. And all of the others are trying to work out all the other details and make sure the journey is going fine. But John, he's just there and he's just clinging to the man. And they're like, why doesn't John just get up and work? Why doesn't John just get up and help? And John is just there. He's like Joseph. You know, the daughter's child, he's just there and he's enraptured and caught up in the love of his father. And I believe it is because of John's thoughts, how he perceived God and how he perceived himself in the eyes of God, that opened up a dimension of purity, that opened up a dimension of consummation, where his mind was just filled with the thoughts of God, that allowed him this moment even more so than the others. Peter said, what will become of this one? Jesus, you just told me I'm going to die like you. I want to hear about John. You go read the last chapter in the Gospel of John, you'll see the story. And we see the things that were concerning him, and Jesus says, what does it matter to you that I would have him to live till I return? I mean, John was just spoiled. But he loved God. And I think it was because he loved God with all of his heart. He was consumed by Jesus. And beloved, when you get consumed by Jesus, when the desire to see him, to meet him, to talk with him, to lay out before him is greater than any other desire, greater than any other thing in your life, whether it be your success, whether it be the things that materially move you, when Jesus consumes your mind more than all of the things of the world, beloved, there is a dimension of heaven that is opened up to you, a dimension that no devil in hell can steal from you. The prince of Persia can come and pomp a set, but nothing will stop you from seeing God. Oh, mercy. Oh, come to the waters. Come and buy without food, without money. Hallelujah. Come and buy from me. Hamraso, says the Lord, gold refined in the fire. And beloved, we need that. We need that. We need the true essence, the purity and the simplicity of the gospel to hit our spirit once again, where everything is about Jesus and Jesus alone. Where I'm not even so concerned, Troy, about the next big move, because, hallelujah, if I'm concerned about him, I'm moving with him. Hallelujah. I'm just lost in him, and where he goes, I go. Hallelujah. And I'll always find myself in the right place because I am in his space. Hallelujah. I am hidden in Christ, in God. I'm not moving from that place. And that's why, beloved, if we're going to awake, if our eyes are going to be opened, hallelujah, if we're going to have the confession of John where we say, now I saw. Come on, put back up the scripture there for me again, please. Now I saw. Now I saw. Hallelujah. We need eyes to see. And John saw. And it was because of his passion, his connection, what consumed him, what filled him. Guys, we have to get minds that are filled with God. If we're going to really live out the reality of this Christian walk, this Christian thing, if we're going to really live and walk like Christ, beloved, he must fill Junior, he must fill your mind. He must fill us. He must consume us more than anything. More than anything. More than anything. More than anything. More than anything I can do for him. Hallelujah. It's more important to be with him. Let me just tell you that. Hallelujah. More important than anything you can do for him, it is more important to be with him. Because when you are with him, you're going to do a lot. Hallelujah. When you are with him, when you are hidden in Christ, in God, beloved, I'm telling you, hallelujah, you're caught up in the fellowship of the Godhead and the things that they are moving in, you are moving in, hallelujah. Last night I got so excited because, you know why? Hallelujah, I just said, God, I just want to abide, I just want to find myself in you, and I found myself in a place just of just supping on him, and as I was supping on him, hallelujah, I just began to see the operation of the Spirit of God and what the Godhead was up to, and it was so exciting to share in the council of the fellowship, and I hear the Spirit of the Lord say clearly to my spirit that this was never something designed for Abraham alone. This was designed for every child of God. God merely but gave you a glimpse when he caught Abraham up into the fellowship where Abraham was in the midst of the counsel of God to provoke decisions made by God with God. Hallelujah. He was a part of signing the legislation that would go into place concerning nations, countries, and peoples. And God was saying, Abraham was just a glimpse. How much more so those in Christ, those in Christ, those in Christ. But that's the thing. You got to be in him. You got to be in him. You got to be in him. You have to be in him. And he must consume you. He must fill you. Now I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals. Who is the Lamb? The Lamb is Jesus. I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals. And I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come. And see. Come and see. Come and see. Now, didn't John say that he saw? Did John say that he saw? What does the first three words say? No, I saw. So everybody should be saying yes. Good. He saw. But yet, seeing what was taking place, there was another place of revelation. There was another place of insight that he was not privy to where he was standing. Even in the midst of being in Jesus' atmosphere. Hello. And this is where I go to next. Beloved, no, not the next verse. This is where I go to next. And that is, it's not enough to just have your eyes open anymore. Not in this time. It is necessary and foundational to have your eyes open to see. But you can see a generality. You can see even in the spirit general things that are occurring. But the Lord wants you sharp as an arrow, man. The Lord wants you precise. Precise anointing on your spirit. This season is not a season. This time is not a time where we miss it. This time is not a time where we see things generally in the spirit and we go call it as we see it. Beloved, there is more to see. And if you do that, you're going to mess up. Because you're going to be presumptuous. And presumptuous has killed many a man. Presumption. But here is the four living creature. One of them. And he says to John, and now I know you're seeing what's happening, but you really need to see what's happening. And so he releases a call with a voice like thunder. It speaks of authority. Beloved, the Lord is not making sport concerning your position in this season. He really wants you in alignment. The Lord is not, well, I think, you know, no. He is speaking like the captain of the Lord of hosts that he is, and he is calling us into alignment. Why? Hallelujah. Why would a parent raise their voice when a child is doing something they shouldn't do, but especially when the thing that they are doing that they shouldn't be doing will get them in trouble, will get them killed, beloved? And that's the heart of God in this season. He is a father, and he's speaking a little bit more sternly to his children. Why? Because the enemy is seeking to devour many, to push many off track. But we have to be in alignment. The voice like thunder says, come, come, come. That word come there in the Greek, it means to move from your present position and to come to the position of the one who speaks. To move to the position of the one who speaks. Just as with Peter on the boat and Jesus telling him to come, he had to move from his position of comfort by surrounding himself. He was surrounded by things that he was comfortable with, things that he knew to be true. I stand up on wood. I'm not going to fall through the ground. It's solid. But Jesus, as he asked the Lord, can I? Jesus said, come. That same Greek word there again. Come. Come. And the man decided to do something that would look, the most ridiculous. He decided to step out of something that was solid and to step onto something that was soluble. It was a material that he would have just sank right through. But he made the decision to say yes to Jesus. Yes to Jesus. And beloved, wherever you are right now in your Christian walk, if you are 10, if you are 60, it does not matter. The voice of the Lord is ringing out in the church, and he is saying, come, come out of your place of comfort. Stop being that mediocre stick in the mud and do what is necessary to shift and to move into position, because unless you get in position, you're going to miss it. And the thing about us is, oftentimes what we don't see, or rather I should say what we don't perceive or understand, we can tend to resist, misuse, or abuse, and find ourselves in trouble. A child can see fire, but unless there's that perception that, yes, that thing is dangerous, then he can find himself or she can find herself in trouble. But the Lord wants us to find our place in him, to come. And then it says again, come and see. Come and see. I want to say that this is said to John 4 times in Revelation 6 alone. Obviously, there are 4 living creatures. It's not that hard to work out. But each and every one of them tell John over and over again, come and see. John, the first one, said, come and see. And then, what did he see? A rider on a white horse with a bow getting ready to march out into the earth. The second creature said, okay, John, you finished that trip. Now, come, come, come. There's more to see. Hallelujah. This is how the Lord is going to be moving in this season. You can't stay stagnant. You can't stay even when the bread is hot. Hallelujah. When it's still there at the table and you've sat and you began to eat. When God says move, you need to move and leave the plate where it's at. Some of us want to stay and eat and eat and eat. Hallelujah. And expect we're going to get seconds and stay where God was. God doesn't want you to be where he was. He wants you to be where he is, beloved. And in this season, we got to be where the Lord is. Oh, God, we got to be where you are. And so creature after creature told John, come and see the next conflict in the earth, the next this and the next that. But the call to come and see, the call to move from that current place, that position of comfort, to another was echoed to John. And there he was moving to and fro, here and there, following God as he released his plan to conquer the earth and to purge it. Now, it is interesting that this is said four times. The number four in the Bible, the number four represents the demarcation of seasons and times. On the fourth day, the Lord created the sun, the moon, the stars, and they were created to demark time, to demark seasons. We have four general seasons in the earth. And so the number four speaks of a demarcation of seasons. It speaks of the changing of seasons. And so more than ever before, God is ringing this into our spirit. Hello. In this time, right here, right now, in this season that we are in on the planet, if we're going to be advancing, we have to be able to discern knowing the season and moving accordingly. Because let me tell you this, the season is not waiting on you. You think if John didn't listen, heaven would have held up? Not at all. The battle plan of Jesus, once the seal is broke, it's broke and things happen. And the battle plan of the Lord will go on with or without you. But the Lord calls us to get into position. Because I'm going to tell you this real straight. It's about to go down. I'm going to tell you in very straight terms. It's about to get a bit hot on this planet. And I'm talking out of the seat of reaction. 3 weeks ago, my wife as my witness, I was sleeping at home. And she was in one room dealing with the children. I was outside going through my iPad looking at some information and doing some research. And I fell asleep there on the couch. And she fell asleep in there with the kids. And about 2 o'clock or so, I got up. And as I got up, I realized that the Holy Spirit had me out of my body. I was carried by the Spirit. I saw my entire living room, my entire space, and I saw myself sleeping. And here I was, and I felt the peace of the Spirit of God. But when I looked at the door, I realized that, hey, Dwayne, you're seeing into the second heaven. You're seeing into the spiritual realm, things that are occurring in the earth. And I went, and the door was cracked open just a little bit. And I pushed open the door, and I looked outside. And outside, running up to and fro the roads and in our driving space and the roads and so forth, were these black entities, and they were moving swiftly up to devious activities and wearing different armaments on their head. Look like people like you and me, but dark as night, without features, but having various levels of authority signified by their crowns, and carrying out activity. And immediately when I opened the door and I saw them, they looked and were jolted in the spirit, and they flew seven ways. When the Bible says the enemy flees seven ways, you got to believe it. When a son of God steps on the scene, I'm telling you, I saw it for myself live in the spirit. Hallelujah. They got up. I mean, they moved. They were like cockroaches when you catch them, you know, all over the place. And I came back and I shut the door and I said to myself, why is this door open? And the Spirit of God says, son, the church has an open door to cancel every movement of hell, but she does not understand her place. And the door has long been cracked for the church to step out and walk and establish authority, to set things in motion, but she does not understand her rightful place. And I shut the door back in, and I went as if to go back to the couch, and immediately, and it's one of the weirdest feelings you feel getting out of a trance, I was just shook up, and I went to my wife, and I prayed, and I was in a place of prayer till the sun came up. I fell back to sleep when the sun just came up, but I couldn't stop praying because it was like we have incredible authority, and we don't know it because we can't see, because we're not positioned, and everything that could be prepared has been prepared for us. The table of the Lord has been prepared, but who will come and sup? Who will come and sit? Who will come and take their rightful place? No, God, I don't want to be seated with you in heavenly places. I'm quite enjoying this material earth. I'm quite enjoying getting caught up in the trivial issues of this planet, when there are greater issues, beloved, that if you would arise and step into your place and control those, it would definitely affect the mundane stuff on the planet. Because what you do up there affects what happens down here. But the Lord is not going to do it himself. You have been called. You have been called to take your rightful place. So more than ever before, guys, we need alignment. Oh, we need alignment. We need alignment. We need to know that the season is changing, and I cannot wear what I would wear in spring in winter. I can't put on the same garment. I would find myself in some serious trouble if I do not prepare my house, if I do not prepare my life, because I'm going to say it to you, and I don't know, but he who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Winter is coming. Ambrosi. And you can't just walk about in winter just like anything else. You have to be prepared. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Oh, Father, even now as we sit, God, Father, there are things that we concern ourselves with. There are things that fill our mind, Lord God, and some of these things we think are so important, but Lord, in the eyes of heaven, they're so small. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask this morning for the spirit of alignment to come upon our hearts right now and to shift what needs to be shifted, to move what needs to be moved. Holy Spirit, even now, let there be a divine shifting and alignment in the midst of our soul. Let there be conviction that breaks the deception. What the Spirit of the Lord showed me on that visitation with him, as we were abiding together, us abiding in the fellowship of God, the Lord said, and Jesus was doing a work in the east of the planet, hallelujah, and he moved his hand like that over the west. And what happened when he moved his hand like that over the west? A veil was lifted off of the west, and the Lord said, I have broken the veil from off of the west, and she shall be exposed, and I will purge her, and I will perform her, and I will lead her into my glory, but through many trial and tribulation, but she shall arise in strength and beauty. She shall stand as a shining and burning lamp for all men to see, but it is a season where she shall be exposed. Beloved, get ready to see some things you haven't seen before. You've heard it years gone by, that 2015 would be an interesting year. It would be a year where you need to, where you would have needed to have prepared yourself for what will come. I've said this on more than one occasion. Apostles have come from Africa saying the same thing. It has been trumpeted over in our ears. But are our storehouses ready? Are we ready for winter? Are we ready for winter? Am I ready for winter? Maybe we should just make it a bit more personal instead of just speaking corporate. Am I ready for winter? When it's all going down, will I stand or will I forfeit? Will I throw in my hand and fall, or will I stand in the midst of it all? Beloved, when I saw what I saw, I said, God, the things that I'm concerning myself about, even pertaining to living, that makes no sense right now because of what I see. God, why am I so concerned with these trivial things? Why do they fill my mind so? Lord said to me, better trash your idols if you're going to be in the army of the Lord. For the greatest idol is you and me. We got to get on the threshing floor. When will we learn that God's strategy is giving glory to the Lord? Oh, let's trash our idols if we're going to be in the army of the Lord. And the Lord began to break my heart and expose things that I thought were good things that were idolatrous things. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you, Jesus said it to the church of Thyatira. You're not going to see. You're not going to come into alignment. Hallelujah. If you keep tolerating idolatry and immorality in your life. Hallelujah. And there's certain things that we must put a full stop on and say enough is enough. When I have become a man, I put away childish things. Come on, church. It is time to put away childish things. It is enough. Enough is enough is enough. It's time to get on the threshing floor. It's time to say no, 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 no. I cannot tolerate idolatry, beloved. I must be like John. I must be consumed with him. Hallelujah. He must be the thing that wakes me up. Hallelujah. That I think about when I go to sleep. It can't be what is going to happen on that next series. What's going to happen with this character or that character. Beloved, it must be what is happening with Jesus. And what is he doing? What is he up to? I want to fellowship with him. God, hallelujah. I don't even want to sleep. I want you to take my spirit. Wherever you are tonight, I want to be. Wherever you are today, I want to go. I want to be with you. I want to be with you. And God, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, beloved, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. Jesus said, whatever it takes, it is your hand that offends you, cut it off. If it is your eye that offends you, pull it out. Whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. The master says, whatever it takes, beloved, because it's not about someone just coming and riling you up. Hallelujah. It's someone that is interested in your soul and in your salvation. And if you're going to shine for all eternity in the age where things really matter, beloved, I'm telling you, all things will pass away. All flesh is like grass. But there is an age to come, and you got to shine in that one. God experiences a standard of life that is so free, so enormous, so out of this world, out of our minds, huge, that he would never compromise his holiness. Because of the standard of living that he's experiencing. Nobody wants to experience. I had a saint come to me and tell me things are going rough. I've never been through something like this. I'm used to always having money and things working out. And it's the first time I've found myself in a situation. And what has occurred now is that their standard of living is being shifted. The plates are moving. And that's what's going to happen. Rose, you trust in riches. They're going to be like the bird that flies away. There is nothing that you can trust in. Not even Egypt's rod. It will break in your hand. And it will prick you. Nothing the world can offer you will sustain you. Beloved, you have to trust in God. He will be the only one. And don't wait until it's too late to find that out. Not your popularity, not your business, not anything but Jesus. He will be the only sustainer of our times. The only stability of our times. He alone. You have to be ready to throw away everything. Because I am telling you, everything that is not of him will betray you. It will have its season. And right now it is entreating you, but it will betray you. The Bible says the word of the Lord will test you. There are things that are working for you now that will turn to work against you. And it's not that it's not good right now, but the Lord will test every man, Jack. Every single person will be weighed. God, bring my heart into alignment. Bring my heart into alignment, God. Expose the idols for what they are. Expose the idols for what they are. Get rid of the stinking thinking of immorality, the disgusting, dirty, nasty spirit of immorality. God, I want to live like you live. You want to experience a standard of living that is like no other? You see that lady, her standard of living got shifted. But beloved, God's standard of living never gets shifted. Hallelujah. And it is marked by holiness. You get into holiness, beloved, you're going to start living life like you've never imagined. You think Egypt has something to offer? You think the world has something to offer? Their celebrities are killing themselves by the dozen. You think they have something to offer you? You think they have something to offer you? You think having a face, having some sense of popularity and acknowledgement from men is going to sustain you? It's rubbish. It's the reason I left the world. I know what that stupidness is. To be on top, to be the most popular, to be the one people want to hang out with. It is the dumbest thing you could ever sustain yourself on. And I was the dumbest person for believing in it. And it was so empty. And yet we are looking for that. For some house to show somebody. For some car. I mean, nothing is wrong with these things, beloved. But we have to measure our heart when we connect ourselves to these things. Wiser words have never been spoken that came, I remember, from the mouth of Elder Harriet. We were way back in the other office. And I remember I had bought my first car. She probably don't even remember this. And she said, listen, when you get in that car, just remember you make it and it does not make you. And that has stuck with me for all of my years. And beloved, we cannot measure ourselves by the puny insignificant. If your frame, one of our young people, Charisse, was sharing at youth, Forerunners, and she quoted Psalms 8. What is man that you are so mindful of him, that you've established him above all these things? Beloved, if God has looked at you and said you're worth more than anything in the universe to him, no angel, no seraph, no nothing can compare with you, yet you're listening to the devil telling you nonsense about you when God says you're the greatest thing ever. And you want to measure yourself by little puny things? By a shirt and a tie? By a watch and a car? Come on now. Wake up. Wake up now. Hello. Seriously. Come and see. Come and see. Come into alignment. Come into alignment. I pray right now, that as Joel saw and prophesied, that we would hold to our hearts and lay down every idol right now. I pray every Dagon will fall to the ground at the presence of God. God, it is not my voice. I can't do a thing. But it is your spirit. And God, you want your church to get in alignment. And in the name of Jesus this morning, God, let there be a divine arrest. Let there be an apprehension that can only come from heaven upon the hearts of men. The Lord, seasons are shifting and we need to move. We need to move. We need to move. We need to displace some things and put some things in place. I dare say, who will take up, hallelujah, the mantle, hallelujah, this morning? Who will take up the mantle? Not everybody can take up the mantle. Not everybody has the courage, and there are too many cowards. And God says, I hate a coward. They're not worthy of the kingdom, but God loves the courageous. Hallelujah. That in the midst of fear, in the midst of you not knowing how it's going to work out, how it's going to happen. Oh, God, I feel like I'm going to lose it all. The fire is burning everything up, God, and I can't hold on to anything. In the midst of it all, the courageous say, have it all. Have it all of me. Have it all. The courageous say, Ambrose, I'm going to stop holding back. Hallelujah. Today, I am calling a fast. Hallelujah. I am striking an agreement with you, God. I am going to change my life. I'm going to break certain holds that have kept me in a place of mediocrity. Because how dare a generation, another one, comes up and sees us in the same place. Whether we have the time for it or not. But beloved, if we do, for another generation, come forward. You have to fight the devils we were supposed to displace. Do you know that when you displace the idols in your heart and in your life, when it begins with you, that you set, beloved, a ripple effect throughout generations to come. You release the Deuteronomy effect, I call it, where the blessing goes from one generation unto a thousand more. Choose blessing. Don't choose the curse. Don't choose the curse. Shift, shift, shift. But I can't stop looking at pornography. Throw the computer out. Gosh, gosh, it's not so hard. It's not so hard. There are certain things you just need to get out. I remember when I first went to Bible school, I carried an idol with me. And it was supposed to... Because I was very insular, and I would find my time, you know, had my bedroom, had my TV, had a little fridge in the bedroom, hallelujah, I had, you know, all of my entertainment set up in there, and the Lord says, listen, get it out, get it out, get it out, but God, I ain't know nobody about here, get it out, get it out. I want to take away your comfort. I want to take away those things from you. Get it out. Move it. Move it. And the Lord made me do that for a year and a half. That may not be big to you, but that was big for me. I cried. I wept. And the Lord said, move it. What is the Lord saying to move? What right now is the Lord saying to move? Who is the Lord saying to move? What? What is he saying to move? Come on, you can't look at me to tell you. You know. Nobody in here is so fancy that they stand perfect. We all have things to move. What is it? It is best you discover it than the Lord expose it. Because he can. Because he's interested in your soul. Oh. Come and see. Four times. Come and see. Come and see. Come and see. As the sun is to the moon. Beloved, we got to set some things real straight and different in our lives. We got to set some things in order. Awake. Align. And find out what you've been assigned to do. You see, you can't run into an assignment with idols. You're going to fail. You can't run into an assignment without having eyes open. You're going to fail. You're going to become so miserable and defeated. The devil is going to sit on you. And everywhere you walk, he's going to be sitting on you. You're going to walk with demons on every shoulder with their talons sunk into your flesh like a crow on its prey. No. You got to see. Fill my mind with Jesus. Displace my idols and my immorality so I can see. You got to get aligned. You have to be obedient to the Spirit of God when he says move, Floyd. When he says move, you got to move. When he says, okay, 7 days, give it to me. What would I say to God? God, oh my goodness, I can't fast 7 days. You know, I go without food for a day. I feel like I'm going to drop down. Well, am I not the one who created you? How will you tell me about the body that I created? How will you tell me how it would function? You know, there was a man that tried that and God jacked him up. His name was Job. You're going to tell me about the thing I created? I'm going to tell you what to do and you're going to do it. And you're going to find out that you can. Because I know you better than you do. I'm more concerned about you more than you are concerned about yourself. And everything I do is for your benefit. What is the Lord saying to do? How are you going to move and align your life into the place of true prosperity with God? We must awake, must align, but we also must be assigned. Revelation chapter 8, can you go there, please? Revelation chapter 8. Let's go down. Actually, I'll read it from here. When he opened the seventh seal, now this is the last of the seals. There were seven seals. After this, there are seven trumpets, and after that, there are seven bowls. When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Then another angel, and I love this, hallelujah, the seven angels with their seven trumpets are about to do some stuff, but then there is another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar, and he was given much incense, everybody say much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of who? All the saints. Upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. I want to say that part again. That he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. Go ahead. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. Go on. Then the angel took the censer and he filled it with fire from the altar and he threw it to the earth. And there were what? Noises, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. And so the seven angels then prepared themselves to sing. Now this isn't a very interesting discourse between verse 1 and verse 5 where we find that in God's battle plan and in the unfolding of it, there is activity that comes from him himself, from the angels as well, but also from who? The saints. Who's a saint in here? Who calls Jesus Lord? Amen. And lives obedient to his name. Who in here? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. You, the saints. And the Bible says that this angel took the prayers of all. What does all mean? All. All means all. All means you. All means me. And the angel took the prayers of all the saints and he mixed it in a censer with fire. And he threw the fire where? Into the earth. Hallelujah. I want to enlighten you this morning that you have been made to sit with Jesus in heavenly places, to operate as Jesus does operate in heavenly places. How many of you know how Jesus operates right now? The Bible says, amen, he is our high priest, forever making intercession for us. Right now, Jesus, hallelujah, the omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent one who is here is also before the Father, amen, in his fullest essence, and he is praying. He is interceding. Not his will. He never prayed his will. What did he pray? In his favorite place. In his favorite place. In the garden. What did he pray? Not mine. Not mine, God. I'm going to drink the cup that you have to offer. I'm praying your will. And so, beloved, in the earth today, I want you to know when you get aligned and your eyes are open, you begin to see what the Lord is doing, and no longer are you wondering, what should I pray about? God, oh my goodness, I just got to hit the general key, you know, the middle C in prayer language, and that is, your will be done. And that's a good prayer, right? Your will be done. But beloved, can I just challenge you a bit that the Lord has called us in you to rise up and to go into deeper waters? That Jesus, when he gave you a framework, meant it to be a framework, and he meant you to be a bit more specific. He wants you to know what his will is. Jesus said, when they said, we can go another way, Shauna, I got to go through Samaria, man. I got to go through Samaria. No, daddy didn't just say, all right, son, my will be done. Daddy spoke to him. Daddy said to him, this is what your day is going to look like, man. This is the journey that I'm going to take you on. You will know it. This is the name of the city. You got to go through here. And so when he got there, I must go through it. I must go through Samaria. Beloved, I just want to challenge us to know that we have to escape general living. Amen. And rise up into a place of specifics. Hallelujah. Where we begin to speak the mind of Christ as he reveals it to our spirit. Hello. Where we begin to pray according to the will of heaven. And beloved, it is in doing so that we enact and help move forward the judgments of God in the earth. But God, I don't want your judgments in the earth. But why are you a Christian? Why don't you go back into the world if you don't want his judgments in the earth? What are you doing? You're wasting your time. You're blind if you don't want his judgments in the earth. I want his judgments in the earth. You know why? Because I want him to come. The Spirit and the bride say, come. Whatever needs to happen for him to come, if tomorrow 1 billion have to get saved, let it happen. But whatever needs to happen, I want him to come. Hello. It was the driving reality in the hearts of the apostles that moved them to do the things they did. That caused them to live such a normal Christian life. It was normal for them. It looks incredible for us, but it was just normal for them. And I want to live a normal Christian life, that type of normal Christian life. But you know what? I must have a motivation on the inside of me, as Peter rang it so true in his letter. Hallelujah, that indeed I must live my life so that I can hasten the day of his coming. You must imagine how the heart of the Lord hurts when the Bible says in Acts 4 that all of heaven restrains him as he desires to come. All of heaven restrains him, yet in the earth there's a bride that doesn't want him. He is so excited and passionate to break the skies. But there's some things that need to be fulfilled, and we need to step up to the plate, and we need to love him like he loves us. It is possible. John 17, he prays, Father, I want them to share in this love you have for me, how you love me. Put it in their hearts so that they can love the same way. Beloved, it is possible to love him like he loves you, because that's what he prayed for. It was his desire, his request. And he desires for us to love him like he loves us. And if he is up there, and all of heaven, you can imagine what that looks like. What does that look like when all of heaven restrains you? What does that look like? Can you just flick on your holy imagination for a minute and get like a child and begin to think about it? Don't go too far down where you're thinking in cartoon now. But because it's real. But what does that look like? Oh, Jesus Christos walks through. He's pacing up and down, and the angels are looking. Look at him. He's pacing again. He's thinking about them. He's thinking about them. He just wants to be with them. And Michael, hallelujah, goes out and says, come on, Lieutenant so-and-so, and Captain this and this, come. He's pacing again. His heart is beating for them. Somebody watch the gate. Shh. lest he breaks out. He is so excited, and all of heaven restrains him. Yet I'm in the earth, just living my day to day. Not loving as I should love. Oh God, I want passion for you. I want to love you like you love me. I want to love you so much that I want everything and anything, all things to come into place. But you would say, like the rich man in hell, send me back. I need to talk to them. They need to get saved. Don't let them come here. If I could only go or send back Lazarus. And Jesus says, no. Abraham, no. They have the law and the prophets. Everything that a man needs to convict him, he has right now. He has right now. He has right now. Beloved, the heart and the mind of the church must shift. Amen. And we must call and join the cry of the Spirit of God, saying, come, Lord Jesus, come. We must understand our assignment. We must understand our assignment. And our assignment is to get into that place, guys, and pray and pray. What type of prayers would fill the hand of an angel? What type of prayers would provoke that being to mix them with fire and to throw them into the earth, that there'd be noises, lightnings, thunderings, and earthquakes? I tell you, they're not patty cake prayers. They're not grenades in the spirit. They're bigger than that. God, just raise your hands right now. Just tell him, Lord, let me get into my assignment. Lord, let me get into my assignment. Let me get into my assignment. God, as you align me, as you wake me up, I know you have assigned me to pray as you would pray, to speak as you would speak. God, let me get into my assignment. Let nothing hold me back. Let nothing shut me up. For at the end of my day, I would have to give account of every idle word and of an idle life. And I'm not about living an idle life. I'm not about speaking idle words. Father, let me find my assignment. Jesus. Last of all, and finally, God, in all of these things, wants us to know that, beloved, if we are going to be sustained in these crucial times where we have to advance. But in the midst of hardness, in the midst of great tribulation, when we do advance, one thing we can never forget, because it will be our security, it will be our stronghold. One thing we must never forget, and that is to abide. Can you pull up Psalms 91? Psalms 91. When we abide, beloved, there are certain things that occur, that come over us, that keep us. And there is a way to fight in this war, to advance through these crucial times, and to do so as a winner. This is it right here. And I want to challenge every single believer that is hearing me, whether you're here or you're viewing through live stream, that every single day of this month of October, you read this psalm at least once a day. Once a day. Psalms 91. It doesn't take too long. I'm not asking that you study it with all of the books and with all of the lexicons. I'm asking for you just to read it once a day. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall what? Shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Oh, what a privilege. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Let's go on. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. Beloved, that language, that is war language. Amen. That in patty cake language, that's war language right there. I'm talking about my fortress. I'm talking about my refuge. If you're going to need a refuge, if there has to be context for a refuge and a fortress, it means there is a war that's going on. And beloved, you are in a war, whether you like it or not. Amen. You are in a great battle that is being played out. Amen. And Jesus has written the script. Amen. And we are winning. But we got to participate. Amen. And in participating, just as a troop going out to battle, they have an understanding that when we go out to battle and we fight, everybody knows that even if we do get separated, all of David's men knew, if we got separated in battle, there is a place called Adullam. And in Adullam, there is a stronghold. And that's where we're going to meet back. It was a place where he hid in his most weakest moments. With the most depressed of men that ended up being the most mightiest of men. Every commander understands that you need a stronghold. A stronghold, a fortress, and a refuge. But the secret is in abiding. In abiding in the secret place. We have to abide in the presence of God in this season. And abiding in God is not talking about just finding your closet at home or finding a secret place where you can go off and spend time with God. That's a very small part of the picture, but oftentimes what we magnify the most when we read this scripture. No, it's a very small part of the picture. It has something to do with it, but it's a small piece. The biggest part of the picture is that in the midst of every scenario of life, you are obedient to God. That is what true abiding looks like. If you're going to abide in me and I abide in you, hallelujah, you got to remain in me. You have to be stuck in me. And you can't stay in your closet all day, beloved. You got to get up and go. There are things to do. You got to get about the Father's business. Amen. As much as you would want to lay in the Father's lap, there are things to do. But at the same time, in there being things to do, I must walk and I must be doting just like John. That as I go to fulfill the call of God, my eyes must be on Jesus. My focus must be on Jesus. I must be lost in Him and in Him alone. And even if he but whispers a word like David, oh, that I wish I would have water from the well. And three of his mighty men heard it and they said, say what now? Did David just say he wished that he would have water from the well that is over by the Philistine guys? There are about 1,000 of them that guard that well. Did David just say that he wanted water from it? Wait. Joab, did you hear right? Yeah, I heard right. Well, what are we waiting for? Let's go get the water. But there are 1,000 Philistines guarding the well. Beloved, they went and they killed all. Got the water and brought it back to David. David held it in his hand and said, I cannot drink this. You guys just nearly killed yourself just to get me water. And he poured it out on the ground because he didn't find himself to be worthy to partake in that cup. But let me tell you this, there is one who is worthy, amen, to drink that cup, the cup of your sacrifice, because he drank a greater cup than you. And you will, in the same way, drink of the cup of sacrifice, but it will never exceed his. You know what Jesus did for you? I hope you do. But he is worthy of it all. That's all I'm saying. He is worthy of your obedience every single minute, every single hour, every single second. He is worthy of it all. Ella Clifford says it like this: if that is the only thing he would have ever done for you, he would still be worthy of it all. Even if he didn't add another thing to your life, he would still be worthy of it all because of the cup he drank for you. David threw away his water. But beloved, there's one worthy to drink of the cup you have to bring for him. Jesus. And you got to abide. I will trust. Go on to the next verse. Let's just read it out. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. What did he say? He shall, don't go too fast. He shall deliver you from what? The snare. Every trap of the enemy that has been designed to take you out. The Lord says you're not going to fall into it if you abide. You're not going to fall into it. Beloved, the only thing you can fall in is the things that the Lord has purposed for you. Hallelujah. Jesus had to bear the cross. It was the Lord's will. And the Lord has some things in his will that are not as nice as we would want them to be for us. But his interest is in perfecting us. I don't buy the gospel that says God doesn't use hard things. He does. Let me tell you, that's a doctrine of devils. Because the Bible never teaches that. And no man should trumpet that from his lips. God uses hard things as well as great things. But sometimes great things are hard because he knows what your heart needs to come into the perfections of Christ. Hello. Oh God, be it unto me according to your word. Even if it's hard, be it unto me according to your word. But at least I know that the devil is not going to get a cheap shot. Because God said, no snare of the fowler will work on me. Hallelujah. No snare, no snare, no snare in the name of Jesus. But there is a prerequisite. I must abide. I must abide. I can't go about willy-nilly jumping here and jumping there and thinking that it's all going to work out for me. I can't stay in the red, in the blood, and then come over here in the earth. This is a good way to put it. And live an earthly life, a worldly life, and then get back under the blood and jump back into the world and get back under the blood and think everything is just going to work out for me. Beloved, you got to abide. I got to stay in the blood. Come on now. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. I got to abide in that blood. We sang about it this morning. Hallelujah. It's that blood. Amen. It's able to remove, to break every chain. And not only break them off, but from keeping them from coming back on you, man. It's time to stop living that life where chains coming back. Amen. Oh, Jesus. Anybody got time for that? And from the perilous pestilence. No plague. No plague. Everybody say no plague. No plague. No plague. I'm telling you. If I stay in obedience to the Spirit of God, in his assignment for my life, the Lord declares over me, if you stay in that place, Dwayne, no pestilence from the enemy will be able to touch you. Hello. 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 Now, I don't figure myself to know the mind of God so well to know what God will or will not do in his great scheme of plans. We still battle with the reality of what was Paul's thorn in the flesh. So I don't point fingers at folk if you get sick. You can't judge people like that. Yeah? Try and judge Paul then. What was going on with Paul when God told him, my grace is sufficient for you? You can tell me all you want. I've heard it all. But I've been in Bible school for a good time, and I've been around for a little while. I've heard the arguments, and I've heard the different positions, and still nobody can say what it is. But the reality is, I know any pestilence that the devil has schemed for me can't touch me. Can't touch me. That the devil has schemed for me when I abide in the shadow of the Almighty. Go on. He shall cover you with his feathers,
and under his wings you will take refuge. His truth shall be your what? Your shield and your buckler. His truth shall be your what? Your shield and your buckler. Beloved, it will be your protection. It will be your protection. You don't have to lift a hand to protect yourself. Beloved, Jesus didn't have to do it. You wouldn't have to do it either. Beloved, his truth. That's why Jesus told Pilate, amen. As speaking towards his kingdom, my kingdom is from another age. And Jesus pulling out his spirit, speaking to him and declaring that I am the truth and that truth that will liberate. And Pilate responding, but what is truth? Beloved, truth is what will be your shield and buckler. Shield and buckler, your protection in the midst of your persecution. God's truth concerning you, concerning who you're called to be, when the enemy is railing against your identity and everything that God has said you are, when all of that comes up against you, you will stand, and like Jesus in the face of Pilate, you will be able to say, oh no, my God, I am this king you're talking about. My kingdom is from another age. You'll be able to stand in the truth of your identity even when it is questioned. Hello? Even when it is questioned. They will come and they will say, you. And you will say, yes, me. Because of the truth of God that you know for yourself about you. Go on. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day. Go on. Nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. Go on. 1,000 may fall at your side, and how much? 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only, go on. Verse 8. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Hallelujah. Only with my eye shall I look and see the reward of the wicked. Go on. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. You see, that's it right there. You've made him your refuge. The Most High you've made your dwelling place. Go on. No evil shall befall you. No. Everybody say no evil. No evil. Nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. Go on. Hallelujah. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in what? In all your ways. Hallelujah. And you thought the devil made that one up. Go ahead. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Keep going through. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra. The young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me. Now listen, here are the prerequisites right here. This is where the context, the perspective changes from first person speaking now, from third person speaking to first person speaking. Because, says God, you put your name in there where he is. Amen. Because Dwayne has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver Dwayne. Y'all ain't doing it with me. You got to do it. I'm teaching you how to do it when you do it this week. Because Dwayne has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver Dwayne. I will set Dwayne on high because Dwayne has known my name. Amen. Go on. Dwayne shall call upon me and I will answer Dwayne. I will be with Dwayne in trouble. I will deliver Dwayne and I will honor Dwayne. Hallelujah. With long life, I will satisfy Dwayne and I will show Dwayne my salvation. Hallelujah, says the Lord. And in the name of Jesus, I declare for those who will rise up and say, God, I will set my love upon you. My love, I declare in the name of Jesus with everything that will come your way.
with everything, that every promise that has been transcribed here, that it will be yours. 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 It will be yours in the name of Jesus. So I commission you, church, both here locally and all across the earth, hallelujah, to get your eyes open. I declare the eye salve of the Lord. Come on, stand with me. I declare in the name of Jesus, the eye salve of the Lord touching your eyes right now and removing every single veil that would want to block vision, that would want to constrict you from seeing what the Lord is revealing in this season. I declare that it is not for a portion, but it is for all of us. For Moses did say, oh, how I wish all of them were prophets. And I declare and I release your prophetic spirit, God, upon their eyes right now. I declare your eyes open to see. I declare your eyes open to see. I declare your eyes open to see in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to do a prophetic act with me. I want you to step out of your place where you are settled right now. Hallelujah. Because there is alignment. There is alignment in the name of Jesus. I prophesy, Hamrose, and I speak into your life the alignment, hallelujah, of the Spirit of God. I declare in the name of Jesus that you will not be a stick in the mud. You will not be mediocre. I declare in the name of Jesus that you will be the church of Jesus Christ. You will rise up and be the mighty army that the Lord has assigned you to be. Hallelujah. Come on, begin to shake those legs, because I declare no shackle or ball of chain can hold you or constrict you. I declare, sons and daughters of the living God, you are loosed. Loosed from religion. Loosed. Loose from the flesh. I declare in the name of Jesus that there's a shift. There's a shift. There's a shift. There is a new wind that is blowing in your spirit. I hear the thunderous voice from heaven, and he's saying, come and see. Come and see. Come and see. Come and see. Shift. 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 Shift, shift into your rightful position. Shift where your eyes will be able to see what the Lord is saying, what the Lord is doing. Shift in the name of Jesus. From every place of comfort, I say shift, shift, shift in Jesus' name. Oh, I see, hallelujah, even as the book of Revelation, hallelujah, says further down in chapter 8 that the angels, hallelujah, grab the four corners of the earth, release four winds, hallelujah, into the earth. Beloved, I see that there's a fresh wind blowing over you. The Lord says you have encountered a strange wind recently. A strange wind, and you wondered, but God, where did this wind come from? And it came, hallelujah, as fast as it went. But the Lord says today, sons and daughters, understand that in this age there will be many things that will come to deceive you. Many false signs, many false wonders. But I have called you to have a seeing eye and a hearing ear. For I have made your ear to see, your ear, your eyes to see. And even today, sons and daughters, I am blowing a genuine fresh wind over your spirit. And you will not be caught up in the false winds that will blow in the earth, for many false winds will blow. But in the name of Jesus, you will know what is truth. You will stand for what is truth. You will not be caught up in the wind of tolerance. You will not be caught up in the wind of compromise. You will not be caught up in the wind of the desert, the wind of Egypt. No, 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 no. You will not be swept away by delusion. I declare in the name of Jesus a fresh wind blowing over your spirit. A mighty rushing wind blowing over your spirit today. Hallelujah. Refreshing you, removing all of the dust, all of the things that would want to block and mess with your vision. It's like the Sahara dust that blows over the island, and all of a sudden things are looking foggy, things are looking a bit more misty, and your body is being attacked. But I declare in the name of Jesus, hallelujah, that the wind of the Spirit, hallelujah, the north wind of the Lord is blowing, and it is removing every sense of darkness over your vision and over your life in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father, my last prayer is that you would teach us how to abide every day, every minute, every second, to live a life that is surrendered to you. God, it's not worth walking out of the fortress in this season, walking out of our refuge. God, we need to stay in position, abiding in you, in that place of obedience. Even as we advance, we need to abide. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, upon every heart, God, that has been shut this morning, whose eyes have been opened, who have said, God, I will not go on any assignment that is contradictory to your will, but I would align myself with heaven. And I will pray as heaven is praying. I will do as heaven is doing. Father, upon those today in the name of Jesus that will do these things and abide, I declare, God, that they will arise and they shall be great in the earth. And that, God, they will carry out many exploits. Listen to me. There are adventures, exploits that you're going to begin to do with God. Hallelujah. Some of you, you're going to see the man limping, walking out of the store beside you, and you're not going to think twice as you did before, because there's a new wind that's blowing over your spirit. Amen. You're going to stop that man and you're going to let him know, hallelujah, silver and gold have I not, but such as I have, I can give unto you. Be healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We're talking about real kings. Come on. We're talking about people of purpose. Come on. We're talking, hallelujah, about folk that are not taking the grace of God in vain, but are rising up to be the church. Because as Jesus said, the hour is nigh. Hallelujah. It is at the door, the Lord said. It is at the door. So let us arise and be who the Lord has called us to be. Amen. Amen. Can the church say amen? Amen. 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 Come on, bless God. Bless God. Bless God. Bless God. Bless God. Hallelujah. Amen. And for those of you who may be in here and you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord,